Now, I want to be clear, I'm not associated with this app. I don't know the guy. I've never met them. They're not sponsoring this video. I'm just a cash enthusiast and stumbled across this app. Once I ran the benchmarks, I pretty much had to tell you about it. Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft, going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days. And today, we're going to supercharge the performance of your Windows disk storage, whether you're running a brand new SSD or old-time spin and rust. I'll show you how to use a magic new way to add Optane cache tiers to your Windows system for maximum performance. If the benchmark results are to be believed, it's one of those rare revolutions like the introduction of the SSD itself where the performance gains are truly stunning at times, and you'll learn how to do it right here today on Dave's Garage. Now, way back in the day, I wrote things like the Smart Drive cache for MS-DOS and Hypercache for the Amiga. I later worked on the Olay presentation cache for Windows as well, so I know a fair bit about disk caching. I always think it's more fun if you truly understand what it is you're doing, so I'm going to start with some background on caching and how it works, as well as some performance strategies before I jump into the nuts and bolts of how to set it all up. I encourage you to hold out so that you know what you're doing, but if your ADD is itching you, feel free to skip ahead to about 1250. About 30 years ago, I downloaded a shareware application for my Amiga. It wasn't a great piece of software, it didn't have any UI, and to be honest, it was quite buggy and terrible. But when I finally got it to work right, it made my machine fast, as in like 10 times as fast as normal. It blew my mind. Operations that took minutes sometimes fell to seconds, and load times were seemingly instant, and the compiler could tear through my code and build my apps like the source code was suddenly lubricated. So just what was this magical piece of terrible software? Well, I don't remember its actual name, unfortunately, but it was the basics of a disk cache, and what it lacked in refinement it more than made up for by freely including its source code. That gave me the ability to peek inside and figure out how the cache was doing its magic. Pretty soon, I understood how to perform block-level device access directly from AmigaDOS. Combine that block-level access with some careful memory management, and you've got yourself a disk cache. I wrote the cache management and control software and bundled everything up into a neat retail package called Hypercache. Prior to that, the Amiga didn't really have any effective caching, and it really made a huge difference in the performance of the machine. As a result, the software was quite popular at the time, and I sold the software directly to everyone from end users to larger warehouses that in turn sold it to computer stores. It was my first experience with publishing an application as commercial rather than shareware. Being a retail package was a lot more work, as it required printing manuals and packaging and shrink wrapping and distribution and a modicum of technical support and so on. But with a wholesale price of $25, it still paid 5 to 10 times better than shareware would have. I released Hypercache 2.0 about a year later, and it was complete with a fancy GUI control panel and newly added CD-ROM caching. I put myself entirely through university with the software and paid off the small student loans that I'd already borrowed from my parents for books and such. I was still bombing around town in my rusty old 1975 Monte Carlo, but that in turn allowed me to save enough money to buy an engagement ring for my girlfriend, who is now my wife of 27 years. Getting married meant I'd be needing a real job, and by then I decided that Microsoft was the place that I wanted to be. This was still well before the web, so I went through my stack of a couple thousand registration cards from the Hypercache software and found a couple that listed a Microsoft return address. Long story short, I cold emailed those folks and eventually secured a phone screen, then an interview, then an internship, and ultimately a full-time job as a software design engineer starting back in Microsoft's MS-DOS in 1993. My first job, naturally, was to write the new Smart Drive block cache system for CD-ROM drives. Put more simply then, disk caching has been fundamental to my career and even my lifestyle from almost the very beginning. I honestly thought that Windows 10, being based on the original Windows NT kernel architecture, already had fully optimized block-level access, and in many ways it did. I don't think you can improve much about caching a disk block with system RAM. Of course, the operating system already does this, and it does it very well. Better yet, it's not just some layer that does its job oblivious to the needs of the rest of the system. The cache manager is deeply integrated with the heap manager and the virtual memory manager and the disk manager to make highly efficient use of the RAM you have in caching your disk. It's also smart enough to reduce or expand its memory use as needed for other applications and so on, meaning you don't have to use a pre-configured amount of RAM. It's built in so deeply that it would be hard to beat, and that's why there has never been a Hypercache for Windows. I thought it was already done well enough by the Windows operating system. Times change, however. That was all long before the SSD had come along, let alone its trifurcation into the subtypes of SATA, NVMe, and Optane. There are simply cases we could implement now, like a fast Optane stick acting as an L2 cache in front of a farm of NVMe RAID drives that the NT Cache Manager can't natively address. Under Linux, it's more complicated, but that complexity is at least partly in service of greater flexibility, as it would allow you to configure your Optane stick as an LVM write cache. You'll have to know someone with a long gray beard, you might have to recompile your kernel and summon a witch for all I know, but I know it can be done. If you can make it easy to understand for Ubuntu, please do so in the comments or at least point me at a good article on it. Under Windows, we have a few options. If you're on Intel and you have the right combination of Intel CPU and an SSD that features both conventional NAND memory and a smaller amount of Optane memory, you can install and configure that SSD in such a way that it uses the Optane for the frontline interactions and the conventional NAND memory for the slower, longer-term data requests. This setup is known as Intel's RST, or Rapid Storage Technology, and when and where it works, it's pretty darn clever. In fact, in all of these cases, what we're really talking about is trying to improve the performance of a slow storage medium by keeping copies of your most used data on a faster medium. If we go all the way back to the first IBM PC with just a floppy drive and 64K of RAM, depending on the OS, it could use some of that RAM to keep parts of the disk in memory. Consider that disks must keep track of where everything is and what the files are named and their sizes and their dates and so on. Getting that information from disk is slow, but if you keep a copy in RAM from the last time you did a directory listing, it's pretty much instant. And that's all caching does. Keeps a small but frequently used portion of a slow disk on hand inside of a faster medium like RAM. You might naturally wonder, then, how the operating system knows what blocks to keep in memory and which ones it's okay to forget about. Ideally, of course, they would just keep everything you've ever read in RAM, and the second access for any block would be blazingly quick. The problem, of course, is that you do not have infinite memory, and so the system must be judicious about what parts of the disk it keeps copies of, lest you run out of memory very quickly. So let's assume that you set aside some fixed amount of memory, like 8 gigabytes, for caching. But your disk itself is a terabyte, much larger than the cache, so which 8 gigs of your 1 terabyte disk should the system actually keep in memory? There are many strategies and algorithms for determining which parts of the disk to cache. If the cache manager has knowledge of how the file system on the disk works, it can take advantage of that knowledge to keep the most important parts of the disk, like the file allocation tables, in memory preferentially over just a random block of file data. In most cases, however, the cache manager is completely oblivious to the contents of what's on the disk and just keeps track of things based on an LRU, or least recently used, algorithm. The LRU algorithm simply throws away the oldest blocks when it runs out of space and needs to create a new cache block. If I remember my computer science jargon correctly, it's the hysteresis principle combined with locality of reference that makes the LRU approach a good one, even though it's pretty simple. The next problem is finding your block in the cache. If you merely kept a simple list of all the cache blocks, it would take a long time to look through them all and find the block you needed because you'd have to walk through them one by one until you found it. Worse, you'd have to do the same for every block that was ever read, whether it was in the cache or not, just to find out if it was in the cache in the first place. Even hypercache, almost 30 years ago, had a more advanced approach. It would break the disk up into local regions and then use an N-way associative hash algorithm to find its block in the cache. It could find the right block set by using the simple hash, and then the list of blocks to consider was much, much smaller. In those days, I even wrote the data transfer in assembly language and unwound the loops into one long set of move instructions. A typical ST506 disk drive could transfer data at a rate of about 5 megabits, or 500 kilobytes, a second. And that was absolute best case. Typical was more like 250k per second, but when served out of hypercache, the read speeds were more like 7,000 kilobytes per second, even on the slowest of Amigas, an increase of more than 20 times. For floppies, of course, the improvement was even more radical. Even more important than that sequential read speed was the random seek speed, however. I remember my old XT IDE drive had a stepper motor, not even a voice coil, to move the heads around. You could watch them move, and they were not especially fast. With a cache, that seek time is reduced to an in-memory hash table lookup, which is effectively instant when compared to physically moving heads around. The difference in the machine's usability was truly night and day. That experience was repeated when I added CD-ROM caching to MS-DOS during my tenure there. CD apps like Encarta and Bookshelf had their performance transformed by the addition of caching. Since the built-in Windows Cache Manager is now so good, I wouldn't have been really that interested in a cache for Windows except for two things. First, I have an Optane SSD that is super fast for small reads, but it's only 380 gigabytes in size. I have a 6 terabyte NVMe SSD array that I would love to use the Optane as a cache in front of, or as an L2 cache. That way, It'd have the random I/O perf of the Optane stick, but the capacity of the large array. Second, I've experimented a little with chia farming as a less environmentally sketchy way to mine for crypto coin. I'm not actively doing any, but I'm still curious about it. Unfortunately, because it uses a proof of space algorithm instead of proof of work, it's very hard on SSDs in terms of wear and tear. The write life of a NAND SSD is limited, and chia can use it up significantly. Optane is far more durable for writes than the traditional flash that you find in a typical SSD. And RAM, or standard old system memory, never wears out from writing to it. So the ideal situation would be a RAM cache in front of an Optane cache, in front of an SSD cache, in front of a bunch of big old spinning rusty hard drives. The data being worked on would be in RAM, while the oldest data would be out in the farm in the hard disk array, and it would all be seamless and magical. You don't have to worry about managing any of it because the LRU algorithm, or whatever approach the cache uses, ages things from one cache level down to the next. Each level of that cache is known as a tier. If you keep your data in three levels, such as RAM and then Optane and then ultimately on an SSD, each of those cache levels is called a cache tier. When you go to read a byte from the SSD, the system first looks in the RAM tier, since that's the fastest. If it's there, great, and if not, it next looks on the Optane disk, the next fastest tier. If it's not found there, the system proceeds to read it from the regular SSD, which is the actual storage medium. In the real world, perhaps it then must proceed to query a local database, or even worse, a remote one. The benefits of any cache are inversely proportional to how expensive it is to fetch the real data. When data is found in the cache, it's called a cache hit. If the data is not there, meaning the system must proceed down to the next tier or to the disk itself, that's known as a cache miss. The better the hit ratio, the better the performance, because it means the data is being found in the faster tiers more frequently. I have a couple of Synology NAS boxes, and on the one where I directly edit 4K video, I've added an SSD cache in front of the hard disk array that comprises the bulk of the storage. I have 60 terabytes of RAID storage with a 2 terabyte SSD cache in front of that. But it's not just any SSD cache. The cache itself is composed of dual SSDs in RAID 0, meaning it reads from both simultaneously for maximum speed. It's something I'll show you how to set up with Windows as well, but for now, we can look to the NAS for statistics on how well it works. My cache hit ratio over the last week has been 94%. That means that 94% of the time when I go to read a block from my NAS, it's actually coming off the fast RAID SSDs rather than spinning hard drives. For reasons I don't fully understand, the cache itself is only half full. It works very well with great response times for editing video and sustained write speeds of more than 600 megabytes a second. That's across the network, and it's still faster than a local SATA SSD at 550. But what's new now that we didn't have a few years back, and what enables this new scenario? Primarily, it's the availability of the Intel Optane SSDs, which are now available at reasonable prices in the enterprise used market. Optane isn't the highest throughput SSD in the world. In fact, mine tops out a little under 3,000 megabytes per second. But for smaller reads, which is the reality of most of the work your SSD actually does all day, they are super snappy. Ideally, you'd like to install your entire operating system on an Optane, but you're looking at about $3,000 for a single terabyte. By using a smaller, more affordable Optane as a cache in front of a regular SSD, much of the time you get the best of both worlds, the fast access time of the Optane and the high capacity of NAND-based NVMe. Your usage pattern will determine your hit rate, which in turn determines how much of a performance gain you'll receive. To set up Optane as a cache in front of a regular SSD on Windows, you had two options before, and both were pretty limited. On Intel, and only the very latest Intel chips with the right motherboard chipset, you could use Intel's RST, or Rapid Storage Technology, that I mentioned earlier. It's the software that does precisely what we've been talking about, using an Optane cache in front of a NAND SSD. In fact, with their latest H10 unit, the single NVMe board shows up as two separate SSDs, one Optane, the other NAND. From there, the Intel RST software does the cache tier management for you. Intel's solution, perhaps not surprisingly, doesn't work on AMD. AMD has a solution of their own which is quite similar, except it has limitations such as a 256GB size cap. That rules out some of the most attractive enterprise Optane parts like the 380GB unit that I have. Even though I have an AMD, I can't test it out because Threadripper is not supported. The solution then is somewhat oddly named Primo Cache for Windows, a software package that allows you to create cache tiers on your Windows machine. Basically, any fast drive can act as an L2 cache for a slower drive. You can also dedicate RAM to be used exclusively for caching. Now, I want to be clear, I'm not associated with this app, I don't know the guy, I've never met them, they're not sponsoring this video. I'm just a cache enthusiast and stumbled across this app. Once I ran the benchmarks, I pretty much had to tell you about it. Now, my test machine has a good mix of storage solutions. It boots from a standard SATA SSD, and the data drive is a three-way striped storage space of three fast gigabyte NVMe PCI 4 SSDs. There is a RAID hard disk array of four spindles, and it also has an NVMe 380GB Optane 905P for good measure. Because it's too small for most things, the Optane has gone largely unused, but we're about to fix that. First, I'll show you how to set up Primo Cache, and then I'll show you the charts and the graphs of the results. Using Primo Cache, I'm going to perform two simple steps. I'm going to turn the Optane SSD into an L2 cache and then assign that cache not only to the regular SSDs, but also to the SATA SSD and even the spinning disks. When the main user interface comes up, you'll see a toolbar and little else because no cache tiers have been created yet. To do so, we use the L2 cache manager to create an L2 cache. You can use pretty much any volume as a cache, and importantly, you can allocate only a logical volume without needing to allocate an entire disk. So although I didn't do so, I could have partitioned my Optane into, let's say, a 100GB MySQL disk and a 250GB cache. Once you create the L2 cache, next create a new cache task. This is where you indicate what it is that you'll be caching. In my case, I'm going to select my SATA drive, my SSD RAID D drive, and my hard drive RAID R. We'll be able to use that one L2 cache that we created across all of these volumes. In other words, one Optane can cache all your important volumes, not just one at a time. And you don't need one Optane per volume this way either. There are two important choices you need to make on the creation page. The first is how much memory to allocate. This is in addition to the memory that the system is going to use to cache it as well. So it's really a way of dedicating memory to the purpose. I'd never short myself memory in order to dedicate it to caching, but if you're confident that you have memory to spare, this is a great place to spend it. You also have the choice of enabling deferred writes. This will massively improve write speeds as it allows your programs to continue as soon as their data is copied to the cache memory, even before it's actually written to the disk. In fact, it could be some seconds before the data gets written out, so if you had a crash, a reboot, or power outage, you could lose data. Only you know how stable your system is and what your risk tolerance is. I have a UPS and I make a lot of backups, so for now, I'm going to live on the edge and turn it on. I did drop the latency to 2 seconds from the default of 10. One feature that I think is clever is that you can also snapshot the cache and preload that snapshot at Windows boot time so that your cache from the last session is already in memory and ready to go. That could seriously improve boot times, but like application times, I've yet to test it thoroughly. Rest assured that if it does, I'll show you the results, so be sure to subscribe to the channel if you're not already so that you don't miss it. So, with all that out of the way, what are the benchmark numbers? Well, they do impress. Let's start with the sequential read number, since those are the ones most often quoted in benchmarks. From the bottom up, we have the drive R, the hard drive set. It's producing under 100 megabytes per second. Next up, we have drive C, the SATA SSD, at around 500 megabytes per second. A big leap above that is the uncached Optane disk itself, which runs just shy of 3000 megabytes per second. My storage space's array of PCI SSDs, drive D, just cracks the 10 gigabyte per second mark. The top three, R prime, C prime, and D prime, are the same drives, but then cached. As you can see, even the slowest of them all, the rusty RAID set, outperforms the fastest uncached array. At least when it comes to sequential benchmarks, the magic appears real. At least for files of 8GB and then 64GB, which was my test size. But remember, with prefetch turned on, a cache can accelerate even some sequential reads because prefetched cache data can then be served from the cache rather than hitting the device again. But that's a detail for another day. For now, let's move on to random performance. The first thing you'll notice is that the hard disk set doesn't even register. That's what happens when you need to move read heads around and then wait for the desired sector to be rotated in below those heads. It just takes time. The Optane itself is the king of random read performance, just as we hoped and expected it would be. Its speed is then leveraged to help provide fast read times on R', C', and D', the cached volumes. I find it interesting that the cached volumes approach sustained SATA speeds on random read speeds alone. Well, this episode has gone on quite long, but there was a lot that I wanted to cover, and I had to push some more exhaustive testing off to a future video. But if you found this information helpful, please give the video a thumbs up and consider subscribing to the channel if you're not already so that you don't miss follow-up information. It also tells me that you're interested in this topic and want to see more information about it. If you're new to the channel, be sure to check out the Secret History of Windows Task Manager and the Why Are Blue Screens Blue video, as well as the C versus C Sharp versus Python software drag racing series. Thanks for joining me out here in the shop today. And in the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage. If you make it easy to understand for Ubuntu, if you can... The problem, of course, is that you do not have... The problem, of course, is that you do not have infinite memory, and so the system must be judicious. Wow, man, it's not that hard of a word, is it? Yeah, I guess it is. Judicious. In fact, with their latest itch... Right. That's not right. There is a raid. Tell me about your raid. There are two important changes. Dance on the plants, grow mainly in France. Whereas the rain in Spain falls mainly on the plain. I learned that from the Beverly Hillbillies. There are two important choices that you need to make on the creation page. And you don't need one Optane per volume. That's right. That's what I meant to write. Just read what I wrote, dummy.